When mountaineers climb Mount Everest, they routinely carry oxygen cylinders, devices that allow them to breathe freely at high altitudes. This is necessary because the closer you get to the edge of Earth's atmosphere, the less oxygen there is available compared with the plentiful amount found at sea level. This is just one example of how variable Earth's atmosphere is and showcases the elemental makeup of its layers, from troposphere near the sea level to the exosphere in its outermost regions. Where each layer ends and begins is defined by four key traits, according to the National Weather Services. These are temperature change, chemical composition, density, and the movement of these gases within it. So with this in mind, where does Earth's atmosphere actually end and where does space begin? Each of atmosphere layers plays a role in ensuring our planet can host all manner of life, doing everything from blocking cancer-causing cosmic radiation to creating the pressure required to produce water. As you get farther from Earth, the atmosphere becomes less dense. The composition also changes and lighter atoms and molecules begin to dominate, while heavy molecules remain closer to the Earth's atmosphere. As you move up in the atmosphere, the pressure or the weight of the atmosphere above you weakens rapidly. Even commercial planes have pressurized cabins. Rapid changes in altitudes can affect the slim Eustachian tubes connecting the air with the nose and throat. This is why your ears may pop during takeoff in an airplane. Eventually, the air becomes too thin for conventional aircrafts to fly at all, with such craft not able to generate enough lift. This is the area scientists have decreed marks our atmosphere's end and space beginning. It is known as the Kármán Line, named after Theodore von Kármán, a Hungarian American physicist who in 1957 became the first person to attempt to define the boundary between Earth and outer space. This line, given it marks the boundary between Earth and space, not only denotes where an aircraft's limits lie, but is also crucial for scientists and engineers when figuring out how to keep spacecraft and satellites orbiting Earth successfully. The Kármán Line is an approximate region that denotes the altitude above which satellites will be able to orbit the Earth without burning up or falling out of orbit before circling Earth at least once. It is typically defined as 100 kilometers or 62 miles above Earth. It is possible for something to orbit the Earth at altitudes below the Kármán Line, but it would require extremely high orbital velocity, which would be hard to maintain due to friction, but nothing forbids it. Therein lies the sense one should have for the Kármán Line. It is an imaginary but practical threshold between air travel and space travel. Various factors such as satellite size and shape play a part in determining how much air resistance it will experience and consequently its ability to orbit Earth successfully. Typically, satellites that are in low Earth orbit, a classification that tends to be given to satellites at an altitude of less than 621 miles or 1000 km, but sometimes as low as 99 miles or 160 km above Earth, will fall out of orbit after a few years due to drag from the Earth's upper atmosphere gradually slowing down orbital speed. However, that doesn't mean Earth's atmosphere is undetectable beyond 621 miles. The atmosphere does not just disappear once you get into the region where satellites orbit. It is thousands and thousands of kilometers away before evidence of Earth's atmosphere is gone. The very outer atoms from the Earth's atmosphere, the hydrogen atoms that make up its geocorona, can even extend beyond the moon. So, if someone were to reach the Kármán Line, would they notice anything? Would they be aware that they were essentially straddling the boundary between Earth and space? Not really. Nothing really changes. This line is not physical, and one would not notice crossing it, nor does it have any thickness. But about being able to survive even for a brief period at the Kármán Line? What if you were dropped there without a bespoke spacesuit or a mountaineering style oxygen tank? If you could get to it, would you be able to breathe at such a high altitude, and could birth even reach such heights? In principle, flight is still possible all the way up to the Kármán Line. In In practice, however, animals cannot survive at high altitudes above the Armstrong limit, which is around 20 km or 12 miles above the surface, where pressure are so low that liquid in the lungs boils.